In the tax bill that passed at the end of 2017, there was actually some really important tax relief for a couple of years for distillers. And that has allowed Michter's and other Kentucky distillers to reinvest. I mean, we bought 145 acres of land that we're building buildings on. We have a second distillery opening in September. But as to the tariffs...
Are you suggesting that that offsets the negative impact of the tariffs then?
I think they're unrelated, but it certainly helps the industry and it spurs investment in the industry. And it's helped us a lot at Michter's. And I'm hoping it becomes a permanent relief. You know, we're such a heavily taxed industry, both at home and abroad. To begin with, you know, as far as the tariffs go,
a lot of sin taxes out there.
There certainly are.
Yes.
No shortage of them.
Yes.
And but you know, as far as tariffs go, you know, at Michter's, we don't believe that it's going to have a material effect on our sales growth. And that's, you know, we're in kind of a unique position. You know, right now we're allocating every single thing that we make. Because demand is exceeding, you know, our supply, and we won't rush stuff unless it's ready.
But you have to plan so far ahead.
Absolutely.
Because of the aging process, right? So how do you plan for what a trade war might do to you?
That's a really amazing question, you know. But we always say, you know, we do all these projections. We'll project like we're going to taste 25-year bourbon today.
Really?
You know, and we're laying down stuff that we're hoping to sell in 25 years. And when we do our projections, the one thing we always say is we're confident we'll be wrong.
Go ahead.
No, I mean, but right Please. Now, what percentage of your output is actually shipped overseas? Yeah. And is it a premium? Because the argument had been made that premium products could withstand tariffs because the consumer of that caliber product, they don't mind paying a little bit more.
I think, you know, I think that that is an important observation, and I think it applies to Michter's. You know, in the U.S., our least expensive stuff, suggested retails $50 a bottle. We have stuff here like our 25-year bourbon that retails for as much as $10,000 a bottle. In the U.S., we're more expensive abroad. You know, so we're not selling to price sensitive consumers. Yeah. We're selling to consumers that want a certain type of whiskey.
And one thing that I heard when I was in Louisville was, well, look, we don't know whether the Chinese consumer with a love of luxury and all things luxe mm-hmm. is going to find this more attractive because it has become more unattainable.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know the answer to that, but, you know, China, I think, is an amazing potential export market for U.S. whiskey. You know, as you've reported, you know, there's been, like, some really nice growth in China on U.S. whiskey.
And here's what I want to know.
Would you stop with the important questions?
We've
got to taste something here.
Yes. It's because the Distilled Spirits Council has said that the sales of hard alcohol, like whiskey, have now outpaced beer sales in 2017.
Why is
that? So can you explain to us? We're going to taste what you've brought us. Explain to us why people are turning to alcohol like bourbon.
I think that there's a growing appreciation of it among millennials as opposed to beer
which
and some other
stuff.
I would recommend, let's start with our 10-year rye. This is the first release of our 10-year rye in over a year. You know, this is a very much a Kentucky-style rye. Kentucky-style rye is obviously majority grain is rye. However, a Kentucky-style rye will also have a fair amount of corn, a fair amount of barley malt, so it has spice of a good rye, but some sweetness. And this would retail in the U.S. for about $160 a bottle and more abroad.
I don't think we're supposed to drink on the air, so you shouldn't have taken that shot. I'm going to turn it this way.
Better to ask for forgiveness than permission.
And then while we're tasting.
So that's the 10-year.
Yes. Okay. And this is our 25-year bourbon.
This is the big one.
Nobody offered me this, by the way, last week when I was in Louisville. Nobody broke out the $10,000 bottle to say, here, taste this.
I would not have wasted that.
Good catch.
Yeah. And, you know, as you were alluding, you know, you really have to plan ahead in the whiskey business, but. You know, the companies are used to dealing with a lot of intangibles and unknowables, and you do the best you can.
You can hold inventory for a while anyway, right?
Well, the great thing about whiskey is that typically it gets better with age, not worse.
Yeah.
Isn't there supposed to be something we eat in between a 10-year and a 25-year bourbon?
That would actually be a good idea we had more time.
Here we go.
But there's a certain complexity of flavor. To it.
That's nice.
There's
nice.
A richness and nice. And a whole cascade of different things going on. And that there's no substitute for age on a really good whiskey. And there's a lot of really good whiskeys from Kentucky.
That's beautiful.
Very kind. Thank
so we stepped on your answer about why spirits are outselling beer and wine now. I mean, you know, does this go in cycles or what's going on here?
Things definitely go in cycles. But I think a lot of it is really cocktail culture. Younger people in their 20s and 30s really are into cocktails and mixology. Mm-hmm. And I think that the mixologists around the country have done a great job. And now, with social media, it's really spreading around the world. It's spreading, to Shanghai. It's spreading right. to Sydney. It's spreading everywhere.
Interesting.
And it's really helping American
bourbon. I don't know about you, but I can't feel my lips anymore.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.